directly. Hong Junsheng developed his own practice based on Chen Fake's teachings. Hong Junsheng's movement is very subtle and compact, and I like it a lot. I appreciate Hong's contribution. At the same time, since I practice Chen Zhaokui's form, I have a first-hand experience and I'm able to fully appreciate and enjoy the finer details of this branch, such as its opening and closing motion, silk reeling aspect, and so on. So, to answer your question, Hong Junsheng's form is more compact, while Chen Zhaokui's form taught by Ma Hong focuses more on Dan Tian rotation. That is the brief answer I can give to you for now. I will talk more about this in future. Hope that answers the question, Ian. Let's move on to the next one. Tai Chi Chuan asked about pausing between two movements. He says he had a hard time implementing pauses in the Tai Chi broadsword practice and wants to know how to treat the sword form and other weapons form in terms of whether they follow the same principle or not. Thank you, Tai Chi Chuan. This is a good question and a frequently asked one as well. Well, the pausing motion is important in Tai Chi form practice. However, the word pause does not imply that the motion will lead to an absolute pause. It is a transition between two comparatively dynamic movements. In Tai Chi practice, nothing is purely static, since each movement continually connects to the next and in between any two movements. There lies a pausing motion which can be either visible or invisible. However, the visibility of the pausing motion does not change the nature of the pause itself. The slower sinking motion is the time to stabilize and internalize the energy inward during Tai Chi practice and make sure the body and its structure are ready to execute the following movement. This is the nature and objective of the pausing motion. It is a rather statically oriented dynamic motion and not a purely static one, and should never be confused with a mechanical pause. Speaking of Tai Chi weapons, the Tai Chi sword and the Guan Dao can apply this concept and practice more than the broadsword. My research indicates Chen style Tai Chi broadsword to be a much later creation than the Tai Chi Guan Dao form, which makes it harder to apply some Tai Chi principles in it. Regardless, the pausing motion should still be there. So, I recommend you practice the pausing motion with the Guan Dao and the Tai Chi double blade sword or Jian. Hope that answers the question, Tai Chi Chuan. Also, please take good care in Shanghai. It is a very special time in Shanghai caused by the public health issue. So, be safe. Let's look at the next question. Lawrence Stacy asked about the significance of the fan in Tai Chi practice. Well, Tai Chi fan is a comparatively new form developed only a few decades ago. It was originally developed for the purpose of health and demonstration and not for martial applications. Of course, anything can be a weapon if you know how to use it, and the fan is no exception. Tai Chi has been diluted a lot in terms of martial application, and the creation of the Tai Chi fan form made it even worse. In the past, they created the Tai Chi fan. Tomorrow, they may even create Tai Chi twerking. So, who knows what will happen to Tai Chi? This form does not have the same practical benefits as other Tai Chi weapon practices. There's just no comparison between the Tai Chi fan and the Tai Chi Guandao, the latter being a real martial weapon used by the Tai Chi founder Chen Wangting in the battlefield hundreds of years ago. So, I do not recommend the Tai Chi fan practice to anyone. I hope that answers your question, Lawrence. Let's move on to the next one. Arthur Santos asked about speed variations in Tai Chi and how to adjust one's own speed during practice. His question refers to my video, Internal Style Concept number 42. Let me replay a clip from that video. Also, circulating energy practice has a close relationship with breathing. In general, the speed of breathing follows the speed of physical movement. In the context of coordination between breath and movement, normally an inhalation will accompany an inward movement, while an exhalation will accompany an outward movement. However, in Fa Jin movement, there will always be an exhalation, never inhalation. It is an important factor to have effective Fa Jin in terms of coordination between breathing and circulating movements in different directions. Thank you for the question, Arthur. Yes, I did say that the breath follows the speed of the physical movements. I said that in order to express that in Fa Jin movement, the breath should follow the speed of a physical movement. In other words, use the body movement to guide the breathing speed. When you move fast, you breathe quickly. When you move slowly, you should also breathe slowly. I did not say that we should not change our breath before the end of one physical movement. For example, in Tai Chi slow motion practice, you may need to have a few breaths before ending a movement. What I said in the prior video was specifically used to indicate the relationship between breathing movements and physical movements. Regarding your question about speed variations in different Tai Chi styles, yes, any style of Tai Chi will typically start slow and then gradually alter the speed. And the Yang style Tai Chi is no exception. Also, there's no correlation between the speed and the quality or level of practice. In other words, an advanced level of Tai Chi practice can still be and should be practiced slowly. However, anyone who practices Tai Chi for self-defense also needs to practice the fast movements, since slow and fast practices have different objectives and provide different benefits. You cannot expect to achieve martial benefits with only slow motion Tai Chi practice. This is a very important point that every Tai Chi practitioner should be aware of. As for recommendations for Yang style Tai Chi videos, I recommend you check out Dong Yengjie's videos. Dong Yengjie was the disciple of Yang Chengfu, and his demonstrations were great and are really worth checking out. I hope I have answered your question, Arthur. Let's move on to the next one. Bruno Nuance asks two Xingyi questions. I'd like to answer them one by one. First, who was the creator of Wu Xing Lian Huan Quan, and what is the idea behind? Well, Wu Xing Lian Huan Quan, or Five Elements Linking Form, is one of the most popular short Xingyi routines. It is taught normally after teaching the individual five elements. Even though this routine is very short and concise, it can help practitioners practice power generation and continuity, and continues to be popular even today. To the best of my knowledge, The linking form was created by Li Luoneng, the founder of Xingyi. However, we do not know what his version of the linking form looked like, since different branches of Xingyi have different ways to express their own understanding, even though the structure of the routine is largely identical in all the branches. I have learned many different branches of Xingyi along with their five-element linking forms, and overall, I like Li Cunyi's five-element linking form since it is simple, concise, and has a traditional Xingyi body structure, which is different from many modern Beijing Xingyi structures. This is what I teach my students the most. His second question is, quote, talking about power generation, what are the differences between Sun-style Xingyi and the other Hebei Xingyi branches? Sun-style Xingyi is just Hebei-style Xingyi in power generation. Some people use the term Sun-style Xingyi. Actually, there's no such style of Xingyi. Yes, Sun Lu Tang created his own style of Tai Chi after practicing Wu Hao style with Hao Wei Zhen for a couple of months. And his Tai Chi is very unique in terms of body structure and movements. While his Tai Chi is unique, his Xingyi is not. Seriously, I cannot see any unique differences between Sun Lu Tang's Xingyi and other typical Hebei branch. He did not develop his Xingyi with any unique and identifiable characteristics worthy of being separate branch. To be clear, Sun Lu Tang was a great martial artist, and I'm not criticizing his Xingyi practice at all. I'm only saying it's not unique. A style can be recognized in the community when people can see the differences between this style and the rest. It is very hard to differentiate Sun Lu Tang's Xingyi from other typical Hebei-style Xingyi such as Li Cunyi, Shang Yunxiang, Xue Dian, and Zhang Zhaodong. I hope I have answered the question, Bruno. Let's move on to the next one. Frederick Gaudin asked a question about the mixed form routine of Xingyi. The mixed routine of Xingyi is not as well known as other routines like five-element linking form and the Bashi or eight posture. So, thank you, Frederick, for asking about this routine. Let me first provide a brief introduction of this routine. The name of this routine is called Zha Shi Chui or Mixed Fist. It is one of the traditional routines of Xingyi. All of the Xingyi branches practice this routine, and it is one of the longest Xingyi routines as it combines all five elements and 12 animal movements into a single routine and allows the practitioner to focus on continuity. It also contains some unique movements such as those of the tiger, which are not found in other routines or single movements. Che Yizhai, the second generation of Xingyi, is agreed upon as the creator of this routine. I hope that answers the question, Frederick. Let's move on to the next one. Immortal Fate asks the question, quote, Tai Chi famously practices push-ups as part of its curriculum. Are there analogous practices in Xingyi and Bagua? If so, how do they compare and contrast in what skills each are intended to develop? This is an interesting question. Thank you, Immortal Fate. Yes, both Xingyi and Bagua have a push-hand practice, but unfortunately, they are not as developed as in Tai Chi due to the nature of these styles. push hand practice is part of the main curriculum in any Tai Chi style since it helps a Tai Chi practitioner develop the ability to sense other people's Tai Chi energy so that they eventually develop their Tai Chi skills for combat and self-defense. Well, Xing Yi and Ba Gua only practice Rou Shou or two-person exercise similar to Tai Chi push hand with the objective of practicing balance, strength, and so on. Thus, a totally different approach compared to Tai Chi. So, compared to Tai Chi, Xing Yi and Ba Gua do apply a similar practice in terms of physical aspect, but with different objectives in mind. Hope that answers the question, Immortal Fate. Let's move on to the next one. Nominal asks, what are the pros and cons of doing a part of Ba Gua Zhang training using a weighted vest? Or perhaps, how to train with weights while still preserving flexibility and not developing counterproductive muscle tensions? How to add weight to practice losing flexibility and lightness? How to recognize the signs of detrimental effects and unflexibility? Thank you for the question, Nomino. Short answer, yes, it's okay to wear a weighted vest. In a prior video, I shared with the community about one of my practices when I was a child learning Ba Gua. My grandfather taught me to practice Ba Gua while holding a small concrete block when practicing Ba Gua. You can apply the same idea to a weighted vest. My understanding is that if the object is not too heavy, then it will not have any negative impact on your flexibility and lightness. There's the Chinese proverb, 举重若轻. Translation, lift heavy things like they are very light. So, this kind of body conditioning training is great, but should be practiced correctly. In other words, as long as the object is not too heavy on your body, then that will be fine. Speaking of the standard of determining the detrimental effects on flexibility, well, as long as your body can relax while holding a heavy object, that's fine. If you find your entire body or major part of your body tensing up, that is the sign that your body is not ready for training with a very heavy object. So, my suggestion is to start from working on holding something not that heavy and gradually increase the weight. I hope I have answered your question, Nomino. Let's move on to the final question for today. Alice Wu Navarro asked a few questions about training method. I'd like to read his comment first. He said, quote, "You made several discussions on historical utopianism and a way to discern old concepts are not necessarily better, 老家 versus 新家. For example, how do you suggest we discern traditional martial arts when something is cultural utopianism? To me, this point made me wonder if the traditional method of training are, in fact, cultural utopianism as a scientific study of sports and biomechanics has many concepts that conflict with the traditional ways of training to achieve maximum performance in martial ability, for example." End quote. Thank you, Alex. This is a great question. I use the term cultural utopianism to express a social phenomenon that people often falsely believe historical claims when they cannot be justified in reality. In the case of the example you mentioned, old form versus new form, I do not believe that old form is better than new form regarding the discussion about Chen style form variations. I think there are a lot of commercial interest involved in these arguments. As for your specific question about traditional training method potentially conflicting with scientific study of sports and biomechanics, well, I would support scientific study. However, at the same time, we should also be aware of the limitations faced by many scientific studies, which could be aspects like sample size, training objectives, training environment, and not to forget funding agencies, vested interest, and their biases. Any claim does not automatically get validated just because it is called scientific, unless the claim actually holds true to the scientific method. Any scientific research should be validated with comprehensive testing, otherwise it becomes mere propaganda, which is no better than cultural utopianism. The smallest of mistakes in the research process can often render the results invalid. Furthermore, the complexity of the human body is a huge factor which often leads to exceptions and caveats in any research result. So, in my opinion, everyone should follow the scientific method, which would include not just questioning tradition, but also questioning and validating science and finding out for themselves if any scientific claims actually work for them. In all my decades worth of practice, teaching and interacting with the martial art community, I have not seen any conflicts between scientific research and traditional practice. Unless the so-called traditional practice was a fake to begin with, something which I'm to expose and correct through this channel. I do not and never will support any false claims in martial art practice. Of course, while I can guarantee that about myself, there's only so much I can do to discourage others from making false claims. People who make unrealistic claims of a practice are actually only promoting themselves, not their arts, which the community should be able to discern. Let me summarize this with the following points about traditional training versus modern research. First, if a claim makes no rational sense whatsoever, it's a cultural utopianism. Disregard any such claims. Second, if modern research disagrees with any traditional training, find out what works best for you and stick with it. Make sure to question both and blindly follow neither. I hope I have answered your question, Alex. That brings us to the end of this month's Q&A. Thank you all for asking interesting and insightful questions, and I hope you find my answers informative. Please do not hesitate to let me know if you have any follow-up questions. Quick reminder to email us at blog@daoyi.org if you would like to have your content published on the Daoyi blog. Thanks for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice. Hello everyone. I hope you are doing well. First things first, next week's video will be the monthly Q&A. Please post your questions in the comment section or in the Ask Daoyi channel of the Daoyi Discord, or email me if you prefer to remain anonymous. I will do my best to answer them for you. I really enjoy doing Q&A videos, and I think it helps all of us get better informed. In today's video, I will introduce Chan Sijin, or Silk Reeling Energy. I have talked about the Chan Sijin in a couple of prior videos already. For example, I introduced two categories of silk reeling energy, Shun Chan and Ni Chan in response to a request from a community member, Mr. William Pamisteri. Another community member missed the offer, Joe Cohen. Sorry if I'm butchering your name. Asked some detailed questions about silk reeling energy, such as the illustration of silk reeling energy in Chen Xin's book, for which I had promised a dedicated video. Today is the day I fulfill that promise. Miss Cohen, I know it is a bit late than expected, so thank you for your patience. Topics covered in today's video include, first, Chen Xin. Second, origin and the meaning of silk reeling. Third, types of silk reeling. Fourth, the practice of silk reeling. Fifth, misperceptions of silk reeling. Sixth, demonstration. And seventh, take away. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1. Chen Xin. Before starting, I'd like to remind you that I have briefly introduced Chen Xin in one of the Tai Chi introduction videos. However, I'd like to reintroduce him here so that you all get a quick idea. Chen Xin, the 8th generation of Chen style Tai Chi, who lived from 1849 to 1929, was one of the most important Tai Chi masters in history. He was the author of the most important Chen style Tai Chi book, the Chen Shi Tai Chi Quan Tu Shuo, or Illustration of Chen Style Tai Chi. He started writing his book in 1908 and completed it in 1919. So, in total, he spent 12 years completing this great Tai Chi work. His book is considered a milestone in Tai Chi theory and, in my opinion, any serious Tai Chi practitioner in China must read it. I always say that there is no secret in Tai Chi. However, if there are any, then you can find all of them in this book. This is how I describe and praise this book. I believe that Chen Xin's Tai Chi book is a timeless classic and will be relevant as so long as people practice Tai Chi. Well, there have been practitioners like Wu Yuxiang and some others that made impactful literary contributions. No other book comes close to Chen Xin's book in terms of the breadth and depth of knowledge. By the way, this book is not for Tai Chi beginners. In other words, this book is for those who want to understand the Tai Chi's theory on a much deeper level after mastering Tai Chi practice. So, what kind of Tai Chi did Chen Xin practice? Was his Tai Chi the same as one of the popular styles of Tai Chi? The answer is, Chen Xin practiced Chen Shi Xiao Jia, or small frame Chen style Tai Chi, which is different from Da Jia, or big frame Chen style Tai Chi taught by Chen Fa Ke branch. After Chen Fa Ke moved to Beijing from the Chen village, the big frame became the dominant style due to its popularity. Still, Xiao Jia is still popular in many areas of China, including Chen Village, Xi'an, and others. Furthermore, I'd like to point out that the original Chen style practice created by Chen Wangting, the founder of Chen style Tai Chi, was the same as Xiao Jia. The big frame of Da Jia was a much later creation by Chen Youben and Chen Changxing, less than 200 years ago. Both Chen Youben and Chen Changxing were the sixth generations of Chen style Tai Chi. Also, Yang Luchan, the founder of Yang style Tai Chi, actually learned the Xiao Jia or small frame. So the old Yang style should be very close to small frame Chen style Tai Chi. Chen Xin reorganized the small frame from the prior 70 forms to 64 forms in his book by drawing inspiration from the 64 hexagrams to imply a relationship between the Yi Jing and the Tai Chi practice. Given Chen Xin's massive importance in Chen style Tai Chi history, many people a few decades ago began to call his form Chen Xin Quan Jia or Chen Xin Martial Frame or simply Chen Xin Frame. So Chen Xin was memorialized by prepending his name to an existing style. Before I can introduce Chen Xin Frame, I have to introduce Mr. Shi Lei, an important though not a well-known name. His contribution in promoting Chen Xin's practice is outstanding. Mr. Shi was a disciple of Chen Kedi, and Chen Kedi studied directly under Chen Xin. Shi Lei wrote a book titled Chen Xin Quan Jia, or Chen Xin Martial Frame. This book has not been publicly published and has only been circulated among a small group of practitioners in the community. In order to understand the Chen style small frame, I visited him many years ago. This is the book he gave me. So far, I have shared this book only with some of my close friends and students, since this book is the only book in China that introduces Chen Xin's Tai Chi practice with a detailed explanation. I do not practice the small frame Chen style, but Chen Xin's book and Shi Lei's explanation do a great job in helping the reader understand Tai Chi concepts and are a must read, no matter what style of Tai Chi you practice. Unfortunately, Mr. Shi passed away on the 4th of March 2022, just 8 days before the release of this video, at age 98. He was a great Tai Chi practitioner and the gem of a person. Though relatively not so well known, I consider him a very important figure in Tai Chi. And his passing was a great loss to me and I feel also to the Tai Chi community. I give credit to Mr. Shi Lei for improving my understanding of Chen Xin's concept. I will really miss his presence, but to me, he will continue to live on through his teachings. To summarize, Chen Xin, an outstanding Tai Chi practitioner, wrote the book Illustration of Chen Style Tai Chi. His book is a must read for any serious Tai Chi practitioners looking to advance their understanding of Tai Chi concepts. Second, origin and meaning of Silk Reeling. The term Chan Si Jin consists of three characters. Chan means reeling, Si means silk, Jin means energy or power. Put together, it means silk reeling energy. Chen Xin created this term and first used in his book. It is one of the many examples of Chen Xin's original contributions to Tai Chi theory. Even though Chen Xin was the first to use the term silk reeling energy, similar terms were used before his time. For example, Chen Wangting, the founder of Chen style Tai Chi, wrote a Tai Chi poem. The first sentences of the poem is Zong Fang Qi Shen Ren Mo Zhi, Zhu Kao Chan Rao Wo Yi Jie Yi. Here, he used the term Chan Rao, or twisting, to describe the characteristics of a Tai Chi movement. 缠绕 or twisting is a two-dimensional movement, while circle healing is a three-dimensional in a subtle way in executing this action. This is why 禅丝劲 or circle healing energy is a much more precise term describing the nature of Tai Chi movements. 陈新 said in his book, quote, 太极拳禅法也 end quote. Translation, Tai Chi is the practice of circle healing. He also said, quote, 打太极拳虚名禅丝经，禅丝者运中气之法门也，不明此技，不明拳 end quote. Translation, to practice Tai Chi, you must understand circle healing energy. Circle healing is the method to circulate your internal energy. You will not be able to understand Tai Chi martial art without understanding circle healing energy. End translation. That should give you an idea of the importance of circle healing energy in Tai Chi practice. Also, worth noting is that in Chen Xin's book, he used the term 禅丝劲 sometimes, while some other times he used 禅丝经. Even though 劲 and 经 are two different characters with subtle differences, they are interchangeable in this context. In Taoist literature, 经 or essence is the foundation of energy, and energy is the function of essence. For the sake of comprehension, I will use the term 禅丝劲 or circle healing energy instead of circle healing essence for the rest of this video. I'd like to point out that 八极拳, a famous Chinese martial art style, uses a similar term 禅劲 to describe a technique. 禅 means reeling, 劲 means energy. 禅劲 means reeling energy or winding energy. Actually, it is more about a technique rather than the type of energy like used in Chen style Tai Chi. Furthermore, 禅劲 or winding energy or winding technique is a common martial technique in many Chinese martial art styles. In many Chinese martial styles, but 禅丝劲 or circle healing energy is a very unique type of energy in Chen style Tai Chi practice. Now, let's look at the famous circle healing energy attribution, which is what Mr. Cohen asked me about in his message. Actually, there are two attributions in total, one each for the front and the back side of the body. Chen Xin called them 人体禅丝图 body silk reeling attribution. According to Chen Xin, the whole body should have silk reeling energy, and all of the silk reeling energy should be circulated with movement. He also emphasized that all of the energy should be managed by the mind, moving inward to the bones and the joint, and moving outward to the skin. There's only a single stream of silk reeling energy every time instead of multiple streams. He also mentioned the coordination between each part of the body in order to apply the energy effectively. Bear in mind that even though these two attributions show multiple streams of energy flows, in martial practice, there is only one stream that unifies all others at any time. I cannot emphasize this enough. To summarize, Chen Xin created the term circle healing energy based on Chen Wangting's Tai Chi poem. Circle healing energy is considered the most important fundamental practice of Chen style Tai Chi. So, how many types of circle healing practice exist? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 3, type of silk reeling. According to Chen Xin's book, there are 12 types of silk reeling energy organized in six pairs. Those are, I quote, 进禅、退禅、左右禅、上下禅、里外禅、大小禅、顺逆禅, end quote. Translation, forward and backward, left and right, upward and downward, inward and outward, big and small, 顺 and 逆. This list can be overwhelming, especially to beginners, because it is not a good solution to categorize these different types of circadian energy.If we analyze those movements, we can recognize them based on two criteria. First, 顺禅 or 逆禅, and second, expanding or contracting movements. With this, we will be able to clearly understand the nature of 禅思进. Now, let's talk about these two criteria one by one. For the first criterion,We have to first know what 顺禅 and 逆禅 are. I have a video talking about this topic. Now, let me replay that part. Now, my second question is, how did Chen Xin define and describe this term? Let's look into his book. In his book, Chen Xin defined and explained顺禅and逆禅, or positive and negative circadian in many places. Let me show you what he said. Quote, 胳膊尽由心发，行于肩，过肘至指，此是顺禅法。由骨至皮肤，由肩至指出尽也。由指至肩。道禅法，所谓入经者，引之而来，使敌近于我者。Translation: The energy of the arm is initiated by the mind. It then transferred to the shoulder, elbow, and fingers. This is the 顺禅. The energy transfer is from bones to skin.And outward direction of energy. The 逆禅 is the energy moving from fingers to shoulder, and inward direction of energy in order to lead the energy inward and the opponent moving close to our body. This is the explanation provided by Chen Xin, the creator of the term 顺逆.Now, what makes this very clear that 顺禅 or positive circadian, clockwise circadian is the energy movement during outward movement. 逆禅 or negative circadian or counterclockwise circadian is energy movement during inward movement. Of course, to practice the correct inward and outward movement,You have to use the right body part to lead the movement. For example, if your hand is working on 逆禅 or inward movement, then your little finger should lead the circadian energy. This is the definition of 顺禅 and 逆禅 written in Chen Xin's book. Chen Xin used the direction of energy as a standard to distinguish between 顺禅 and 逆禅.This is the original source of this term. Chen Zhaokui, the son of Chen Fa Ke, created another method to distinguish between 顺禅 and 逆禅, which has been used for decades now in China. According to this method, 顺禅 is the movement in which the little finger leads the energy moving towards the center of the palm, just like this.Well, 逆禅 is the movement in which the thumb leads the energy moving toward the center of the palm, just like this. Bear in mind that both hands and feet need to have a simultaneous 顺禅 and 逆禅, and in this video, I will use hand movements to explain the term. Now that you have understood the difference between 顺禅 and 逆禅,Let's talk about the second criterion, is pending or contracting movements. This criterion is rather simple since it's obvious to everyone that a pending movement such as punching involves the release of energy towards the opponent, while contracting movement such as pulling and leading involve moving inward in order to lead the opponent toward yourself. So, when we combine these two criteria together, we get four combinations of movements. They are expanding Shun Chan, expanding Ni Chan, contracting Shun Chan, and contracting Ni Chan. So, if we use Chen Zhao Kui's method, we can organize all of the circulating energy into these four types of circulating movements. Now, let me briefly explain them one by one. First, expanding Shun Chan. Hands move outward with Shun Chan, like this. Second, expanding Ni Chan. Hands move outward with Ni Chan, just like this. Third, contracting Shun Chan. Hand move inward with Shun Chan, just like this. And fourth, contracting Ni Chan. Hand move inward with Ni Chan, just like this. Bear in mind, movement of the energy in this context also includes aspects like intention, variation of the strength, expected martial effect, breathing pattern, and so on. Going forward, you should try to use the method to analyze each Tai Chi movement with respect to circulating energy, since it is a much clearer approach. Topic 4. The practice of circulating. Since circulating is the fundamental practice of Tai Chi, certain principles should be followed in order to achieve the ideal result. Let's look at some important aspects of circulating practice. Tai Chi practice emphasizes Dan Tian, so you should never ignore the function of Dan Tian in your circulating practice. According to Chen Xin, the mind governs the body, and the lower Dan Tian area is the source of internal energy or the area that generates martial power. Any martial movement being the carrier of martial energy should start from the lower Dan Tian area and then extend to the desired place, such as hands and feet. Following the extending movement, energy will return to the lower Dan Tian after execution of inward movement. So, there is the cycle of energy flow between Dan Tian and the limbs, or integration between physical movement and energy flow, which should be emphasized by all Tai Chi practitioners. In other words, Tai Chi practice involves practicing different cycles, and all of the cycles should eventually connect to the Dan Tian area. This is the very important guiding principle in circulating energy practice. Again, mental focus and martial intention are key factors in circulating energy practice. You may not want to add martial intention into your practice since you practice Tai Chi only for health. Regardless, mental focus is critical in circulating energy practice. Furthermore, specific movement requires specific mental focus. Visualizing the energy flow when working on physical movements will accelerate your progress in practice. Any Tai Chi practice lacking in mental focus cannot be considered Tai Chi practice. I'd like to emphasize the importance of Fa Jin in Chen style Tai Chi training. Many people are under the impression that Fa Jin is against circulating energy. That is a misperception. I will clarify it in the following section. So, Tai Chi practitioners just cannot avoid Fa Jin in their circulating energy training if they want to achieve any martial benefits. One of the functions of circulating energy is to smoothen the energy channels of the body and make energy flow smoothly in and out of the body so that it can be released whenever necessary for martial applications, which is nothing but Fa Jin. Unless you want to practice Tai Chi only for health, Fa Jin in circulating motion is the must-have. Also, circulating energy practice has a close relationship with breathing. In general, the speed of breathing follows the speed of physical movement. In the context of coordination between breath and movement, normally an inhalation will accompany an inward movement, while an exhalation will accompany an outward movement. However, in Fa Jin movement, there will always be an exhalation, never inhalation. It is an important factor to have effective Fa Jin in terms of coordination between breathing and circulating movements in different directions. Since circulating energy is the foundation of all Tai Chi movements, you should not only practice the Tai Chi routine by focusing on the circulating energy in each movement, but more importantly, you should also practice single movements in order to practice specific circulating energies. I will introduce one such single movement in the demonstration section. Topic 5. Misperceptions of circulating. Clarification of misperceptions can help us comprehensively understand a topic, and circulating is no exception. Let me share some of the most common misperceptions of circulating energy practice. They are, first, circulating only involves the arms and hands. Second, circulating does not involve Fa Jin. Third, circulating is practiced only in Chen style Tai Chi and not other styles of Tai Chi. Fourth, circulating is only used in Tai Chi practice. There are others wrong. Let me explain them one by one. First, circulating only involves the arms and hands. This is not a mere mistake, but a crime in Tai Chi practice. Bear in mind, Tai Chi practice is never limited to arm and hand movements, but instead engage the entire body. In other words, when one body part moves, so the others in coordination. Any Tai Chi movement should not be done in isolation. Of course, some parts of the body move more than the others, making their movements more pronounced, while movements of the other parts are more subtle and often go undernoticed by the untrained eye. An advanced practitioner should be able to integrate all of the movements as one in order to achieve an optimal martial effect. Second, circulating does not involve Fa Jin. Another very common misunderstanding of Tai Chi and Fa Jin. As I have mentioned in a prior section, Fa Jin is an important practice of Tai Chi. There's no conflict between Fa Jin and circulating energy. On the contrary, practicing circulating energy can amplify your Fa Jin. If you have a hard time with Fa Jin, I recommend adding circulating to your practice. So, Fa Jin and circulating are not mutually exclusive, but instead, mutually strengthening aspects. Third, circulating is practiced only in Chen style Tai Chi and not the other styles of Tai Chi. You have to know that even though other styles of Tai Chi do not use the term Chan Si Jin, circulating energy does exist in all of the Tai Chi styles. Whether self Tai Chi uses the term or not does not change the nature of the practice. For example, in Yang style, people use Chou Si Jin or silk pulling energy to describe the characteristics of that stealth movements. Actually, Chou Si Jin emphasizes the subtle continuity of Yang style practice at the macro level, while Chan Si Jin in Yang style Tai Chi is at its micro level, which is part of Yang style as well. So, even though other traditional Tai Chi styles may neither use the term circulating energy nor have obvious circulating movements in their routine, circulating energy is present in those Tai Chi styles all the time. Fourth, circulating is only used in Tai Chi practice. This is another misunderstanding. Again, using different terms to describe the same practice is a common phenomenon in martial art practice, and circulating energy is one such example. Both Xing Yi and Ba Gua use circulating energy, though mentioned in different terms. For example, in Xing Yi, we call it Qi Zuan Luo Fan. Qi means to move upward. Zuan means drilling. Luo means moving downward. Fan means turning. So the words Zuan and Fan, or drilling and turning, share the same practice as circulating energy. In Ba Gua, we use the term Zhuan Zhang Ru Ning Sheng, or turning your hands like twisting ropes. So the rope twisting motion is synonymous with circulating energy. Therefore, circulating energy is a common concept in all three internal styles, though present with different names and with different practices. Were just four of the many misconceptions regarding circulating energy. I will introduce more in the future. Topic 6, demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate a circulating exercise, which is the double hand circulating movement. In that exercise, one hand works on Shun Chan, while the other hand works on Ni Chan. It is the arm movement of the Tai Chi from a waving hand. To practice this exercise, you keep a stable Tai Chi stance, and then sink down the body, relax the hip area. Then look at the direction where palms come. Okay. Then shift the weight. Then shift the weight. Then shift the weight. Be careful this movement in front of the shoulder. Then the knees make small circular movement, and the body shift the weight with the backward and the downward arc. Then you can make the movement slower. Topic 7, takeaways. First, Chen Xin, an outstanding Tai Chi practitioner, wrote the book Illustration of Chen Style Tai Chi. His book is the must read for any serious Tai Chi practitioners looking to advance their understanding of Tai Chi concepts. Second, Chen Xin created the term circulating energy based on Chen Wangting's Tai Chi poem. Circulating energy is the spiral-like movement that is considered the most important fundamental practice of Chen style Tai Chi. Third, Chen Xin and Chen Zhaokui used a different method in the classification of circulating energy. Fourth, in the practice of the circulating, the mind governs the body, and the lower Dantian area is the source of internal energy, or the area that generates martial power. So green energy practice should integrate mental focus, breathing pattern, physical movement, martial intention, and so on. Fifth, misperceptions of circle reeling. First, circle reeling only involves the arm and the hands. Second, circle reeling does not involve Fa Jin. Third, circle reeling is practiced only in Chen style Tai Chi and not other styles of Tai Chi. Fourth, circle reeling is only used in Tai Chi practice. Bear in mind, all these are misperceptions and should be avoided. Remember to check out the demonstration section to get the concrete idea of how to practice circle reeling in Tai Chi. And a quick reminder to send me your questions for next week's Q&A. That brings us to the end of today's video. Thanks for watching. See you next time and enjoy your circle reeling practice.
拈花舞动风云起，问道倾城学太极。
我是生在黑龙江的绥滨县嘛，所以叫刘绥滨。但是因为当时身体差，体弱多病，所以我一岁的时候，我外婆就把我背回四川，背回都江堰了。
来，
走。走。因为我们家族就是青城派的武术世家，所以我六岁的时候，差不多就开始跟着我外公在练。真正喜欢上是十多岁的时候，因为害怕吃药打针。就从被动练武变成了主动练武。我是32岁的时候，跟随我的师父余国雄学习青城玄门太极。现在我是青城派第36代掌门人。所以那时候就经常会受伤，练武练暴躁了，练来好勇斗狠。后来我练了太极，练了3年以后呢，我就发现我的脾气变好了。以前谁要说打得过我，我一定要打上门去，要把他打服气为止。现在人家说谁打得过我，说对的对的，他就是打得过我。以前的青城太极是相当于是历代掌门单传的，一代就只传了一个人。我当时跟我师父讲，我说这个青城太极并不是哪一代掌门人的私有财产，它是人类共有的智慧。所以我是希望他同意我把他传播出去。那么最后折中的结果呢，他同意我把第一路传出来，就是36式传出来。像我们当时2000年来推广的时候，很多人就不认可。就在太极拳里面，它有几个原则，一个就是要虚灵顶紧，就是这个脖子要竖起来，下颌要内收，眼睛要平视前方。但是在我们的太极里面呢，就会有抬头的动作，有埋头的动作。第二个呢，在我们常规的太极拳里面要求沉肩坠肘，但是我们呢恰恰会有抬肘， 抬肩、翘掌这些动作要。你说这个哪像太极拳？不是太极拳。从内在呢，它也跟很多太极拳不一样，就是我们会有涌动。道家是因为你这个十个手指上有三个阴经、三个阳经，就是手三阳、手三阴，是连到我们的五脏六腑的。所以我们做这个涌动的时候，它就会对我们的内脏功能形成一个牵拉、一些按摩。所以这个也是其他太极拳没有的。很多太极拳人家说练了不累，练我的就特别累，而且会出现疼痛，就是因为我们出现了拉筋。这个也是道家的追求，因为道家认为筋长一寸，寿延十年，所以他这个就跟常规的太极不太一样。食指对膻中穴顶肘，圆背抬头往下压，三指结印，肘关节不打直。我原来教了20多年，我才教了10000人。如果说我要教100000人的话，我要活270岁。但是我得到了社会各界的支持，青城太极全民健身运动纳入市委政府目标考虑，一年就做了我270岁要做的事情。现在我们都建有20多万人会打青城太极，我们都是有280万人会打各种各样的太极。我们现在在全世界有80多个国家，有上100万人在练青城太极的人。
I'm in Dubai with Steven Seagal, and in the previous episode, he taught me and my brother some amazing techniques. Time for session number 2 with Sensei Seagal. But before training starts, he wants to give me a very special gift. In Japanese, we call it a makiwara.
And this is yours, the brand new one.
Wow. Just like the old samurai practiced by hitting wood, Sensei Seagal hits the makiwara because he uses his body just like a sword.
I can hold this for you and you can do your first punch.
Okay, thank you.
So hold it like this?
Yeah, don't knock it out of your hand.
Okay, and I go.
That's right.
Was that okay?
Yes. Yeah.
I hit it wrong.
Well, see, that's where this comes in.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. Amazing. Thank you so much for this precious gift.
This is one of a kind.
Only one in the world.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
See, it's kind of going like this with him.
Yeah.
Talk about this punch. So we're here, and you're going to turn. Okay?
I'm going to turn.
Right?
Yeah.
If you'll notice, if I have my hands up and this goes to turn, it's bigger.
Yes.
And it can get blocked easier.
Yeah.
Okay? And stand strong.
Yep.
Pay attention. You're paying attention? Oliver, you sure?
Yes, sir.
Watch this. Okay, see, here's what's happening. It's going here and here because he's good. So he knows how to turn his toe in and he knows how to make it come here also. But it's also going into his shoulder.
Right.
Now watch this.
Yeah.
If I hit him like this, there's a lot of shock.
Yeah.
You know? But when I hit him like this, you can feel a different penetration. When we're here, and we do this kind of thing, you can even do this. Mm. Now I've trapped his hands. Okay? Mm. This is the kind of thing I want you to learn. Mm. So we're here, we do this kind of thing, look at the hand again, look at the feet again.
Mm. Yeah.
Now, in my style, I would just take this and go into, you know, something like that.
Right.
But you can't do that.
Right.
But you'll still have both of his hands down.
Yeah.
And from here, you certainly can hit him.
Mm. Yes. You want to try?
Yeah.
This is being trapped.
Exactly.
And don't think from here we can't hurt you. Because from here we can do a really great uppercut, really great punch in the face, which I'm not hitting any in the face now, but I just want you to feel what I can do.
Do you have a certain type of footwork to achieve this?
In my footwork, it's always like a triangle.
Rodachi.
And I'm always sliding.
Right.
I don't do this thing that you guys are doing.
Right.
No jumping around.
No bouncing.
I don't do that ever.
Yeah.
I will just stand here. Stand here, stand here. In your style, you're going to move.
Right.
As you're moving, don't jump around a lot. Mm. Don't do this stuff.
Right.
If you move, just move like this. And from here, take your shot.
Yeah.
You notice how I waited for the right body position?
Yep.
Everybody in boxing and karate, they'll say, get the right body position.
Yeah.
But they never say, get his right body position and your body position together. So let's talk about kicks now.
Okay.
When you do Mai Gedi, for example.
Okay. Yep. Yep.
Okay. You all right?
Yeah, I'm good.
So when you kick.
Yeah.
All right, back to me.
This is sword.
Same
when
idea.
You kick,
yeah.
This is sword.
Yep.
Yeah. Try that.
Okay.
And then,
Wow.
That's pretty
smart. That's a new one. You want to try?
You're way too late, Oliver.
Okay.
Way too late. You got to move in much sooner.
Okay.
Move in much sooner. No, you're standing back and waiting.
Okay.
Now, that's it.
Ah, right. You're meeting him.
Yeah, you can't stand back there.
Right. How would that work for Mawashigeri?
So Mawashigeri, there's a thousand ways to do it, but as you come.
Right. Whoa!
This is one of the ones that I like.
That was also a new one.
Yeah. So as you come.
Literally pop.
And I'm hitting you nicely without
my
knuckles.
Yes.
To try to not
But you hit
you.
The exact right spot both times.
Yeah. Where did
that
he
precision hit? is like right there. You can see it's already starting to bruise. You see that?
Yeah.
Yeah, right here. At the top of the kneecap.
And I'm
like
not
this.
Hitting him here. I'm just hitting him here so I don't hurt him.
Because
if I were to hit you here, you'd be hurt.
Wow. That's insane. You gotta feel that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So as you come to kick, I'll turn. You know, I'm covering this much distance. There are stupid people who are saying, you can never do that, this punch.
Yeah.
I've done it 1,000 times.
Yeah.
And I just did it.
I guess it's like with everything, you just need to practice. If you just try it out once, of course you're not gonna get it to work.
Right.
You need to do it hundreds, thousands of times.
Yeah. Wow.
Let's take a little break.
Yes, thank you very much.
In Okinawa and different parts of Japan, you'll hear karate masters say, karate begins with kata and ends with kata.
Yeah.
I don't believe that and I don't agree with that.
No.
My teachers told me, learn waza from the master.
Yeah.
Fight,
yeah.
Perfect your waza, and go back to the master and learn more waza.
Yeah.
I'm trying to spend 60-70% giving you guys spirituality, philosophy, because the technique, even though you might be amazed or you might be interested, that's the not the most important thing.
Yeah.
My master used to say, little finger can make a big man cry. And what he meant by that is, you have really 10 weapons.
Exactly, yeah.
One time somebody pulled a knife on me and he said, okay, now what are you going to do? And I said, I have 10 weapons, you have one. Because he was concentrating on this.
Yeah.
That was all he knew.
Yeah.
I was concentrating on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 5, 10. Yeah. But also the fingers are part of the hand. So if we want to sever your spinal column, we can hit you right there. That's
oh,
it.
Man,
we don't do that with the fingers. We do that. Really, we hit here. I don't know if the camera can see that.
Yeah.
get it here and then here.
Yeah.
And you notice when I do this, it turns it into a very thin knife.
Yep.
When I do this, it becomes thick.
So this is more like a blunt weapon, and this is more sharp.
Yeah, that's right.
The Dust King, exactly. Join up.
If you want to show mercy, you do that.
Yeah. Join
mercy is for after they're sleeping.
Okay.
Or will.
Because everybody's life is precious, but when somebody steps outside of
or
normal parameters of human behavior to the point where they become a danger to humanity, it's our job as the geisha to neutralize. Don't you agree?
Yeah.
So let's do little fingers now. You ready?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Here like that. This in the eyes.
Yeah.
You know.
Exactly.
Or this.
That was right on the spot.
Yeah.
Let's say Oliver is fighting, mm-hmm. and he wants to try to use some of the finger techniques.
My favorite would be to come here, and then here.
Ooh.
And then here.
Yeah.
And this is a break.
Yeah.
This is a break.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
He's really finished here.
Yeah.
Can you feel
How do you
that?
Feel?
Yeah. But I mean, we do we do have him.
Yeah, here. Why are you here? Get to work.
So, he has his hands up here. I come into the eyes. I take this down here, and I bring this up into this.
Yeah.
This is called Sankyo. And if I want to break it, I snap it back very hard and fast, and it's broken.
Yes.
Otherwise, I come into here.
Yeah.
I control him.
Yeah.
Or I come into here.
Ah.
Yeah.
So when we're here, any time like this, it's that down movement.
Ah. Yeah.
Anytime his fingers are anywhere, that's all I need.
Yep. You would try to.
Don't do this.
Okay.
It's like sword.
Oh, okay.
It's like sword.
Yes.
Stand strong.
Okay.
Can't do it very easily. Watch what happens when I back up and lead you. And I'm leading you into my knee or my foot to kick you. When you're here, stand strong.
Yeah.
Stand strong.
Yeah. Yeah. And the cool thing is, this is legal in MMA.
It is legal.
It is.
Nobody does it.
It's legal.
Most of all, understand when I punch, for example, don't do this kind of thing. From your hip. When you watch a bird who's sitting there and he takes off, do you see him go like this?
Mm.
You don't see nothing.
Yeah.
So this is how a good punch is. Just like a bird taking off on the fly.
Immediate.
It's effortless.
Yes.
You don't see it.
Yep. Yeah.
1 minute he's here, the next minute he's in the air. Watch. Don't move.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
Well, see it.
No.
6%.
Okay, I'll change battery.
Sensei Seagal said that there are thousands of amazing martial.
Okay.
Watch, don't move.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
1 minute he's here, the next minute he's in the air. Watch, don't move.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
You don't see it?
No.
6%.
Okay, I'll change battery.
Before he
Sensei Seagal said that there are thousands of amazing martial artists in America, including Danny Nosanto, Tadashi Yamashita, Fumio Demura, Ed Parker, and many more. But perhaps the most famous one was Bruce Lee.
Steve's like, oh, one of my faves, man.
Picture this. You're walking down a dimly lit street late at night, Aikido, and all of a sudden, two attackers jump out of nowhere.
Aikido,
what are you
going to
do?
Movies,
most people are going to freeze. Most people are going to get their teeth kicked in,
like
but not you.
Flavor
the reason is, you're going to grab your free copy
kicking,
of this book that
like,
I'm...
It's about Bruce Lee all the time, and I think Bruce Lee was very unique. Like any other
unique.
Human being, he was human. One of my students was a guy called James Coburn, and when I'd go up to his house in the valley, Bruce Lee was there a lot. Did I know Bruce, talk to him, learn from him, nothing like that. But
break the dude's
I did
arm.
Get to see him and watch him and talk to him.
You know, I take a guy out real quick. That's what I like about
And I can tell you that his sidekick, his Yokogiri, was spectacular.
Jackie Chan
the best
would be like
I've ever seen
running around,
day.
Using the
Much
environment.
Much better than me ever was, ever will be. Ever
Van Damme was like
his stuff with Urokan and
beautiful.
Punching the front stuff like that. Yes, he was very fast, but I know other people also... Just
Johnny possible. And Jay Lee, they're just like straight up.
I'm speaking my opinion.
Yeah, obviously. Sure.
When you have people talking about how, Jean LaBelle used to teach Bruce Lee, and Jean LaBelle beat him up and
choked him out. And there were some other ones that, like,
if Jean LaBelle said that, and he probably did, he is a pitiful liar. And in my opinion, and this is based on the way I know the Lee family and how close I am with Daniel Osanto, who I think was one of the closest to Bruce Lee, I can guarantee you they never fought. I can guarantee you Jean LaBelle never beat up Bruce Lee or anything like that. Never did, never could.
So how about the fact that a lot of people seem to exaggerate Bruce Lee's abilities? What do you think that is? Why do they put him on such a high pedestal?
I mean, people love to have a hero. They love to have this mythical, idea of someone larger than life and bigger than life. Yeah, in many ways, he probably was.
Like, can you represent the fighting style?
Yeah.
He was amazing.
How would you like Steven Seagal to be known and remembered?
Most important thing to me is to be able to impart a spiritual philosophy to my students that they understand never to use what I've taught them unless they have to. But conversely, that my stuff is tremendously dangerous.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering, do you have any kind of final piece of advice for people out there who are watching this? What do you think should be their main takeaway from all that we've said today?
Main takeaway is, rather than practice with 50 different people for 10 years, spend time to find one good teacher who can teach you the spirituality, the philosophy, the theory, and learn from that master. Take your time, don't be in a hurry. Learn the basics. Practice hard with one great master.
Yeah.
That's my best advice.
Yeah.
And with those wise words, it was time to visit the world's tallest building for an unforgettable Japanese dinner. Turns out, Sensei Seagal likes his food just like his martial arts. Because you only live once, and if you do it right, once is enough.
Scripps MD Anderson Cancer Center. We're here for good.
Well.
What's up, guys?
There we have him, the man, the myth, the legend.
This is Steven Wonderboy Thompson. He's the greatest karate fighter in the UFC. But how does he do it? The last time I tried to use karate in a cage, it ended with 3 stitches. Maybe I used it wrong. To find out the answer, I decided to visit Wonderboy,